IVM.
VL, also known as Varta Lab, is a delightful concoction of stories featuring comedians Akash Mehta and Naveen Narona, father and son. Together, they tell stories to each other from their lives and welcome others to do the same. It's all fiction with plenty of adult humor, touching, feeling, holding, caressing. Episodes available at the IVM website, app, or wherever the hell you get your podcast from. The language used on the podcast may not be fit for consumption. We warn you, tread carefully. But listen, yaar, don't be so conservative.
You're listening to Cyrus Says.
Cock and Bull is the name of our show. It used to be Cyrus Says, but this is a review of 2018, the entire year. What does that mean? I'll explain. Listen carefully. It means the entire year. January, February, March, April, May, June, July, August, September, October, November, December. Maybe that's too much. We'll just do what we can.
Why follow your auntie's advice when you can follow Cyrus Says on Facebook and Twitter to stay updated about the latest shows?
Yes, on Cyrus Says, it's time for me to talk about two things. Nasiruddin Shah. Okay, it's one thing, but two names. Nasiruddin Shah and me go back a long way. We did a film together called Jalwa back in 85, if I'm not mistaken. We're almost of the same vintage, a couple of years difference in age. He has 4 more awards than me, that's all, for acting. But the point here that I'm trying to make is, why did he not attend the Ajmer Lit Fest? Why was he, you know, not allowed to attend? Well, apparently it was just a simple case of writer's block. Because he wrote his, if you guys remember his biography, which came out last year, and so they blocked him this year from entering. It's called Cyrus Says.
And that's what Cyrus says.
And now we ask one of the greats of the music industry, and by one of the greats, I mean, of course, Himesh Reshammiya, to give us a little introduction, because we're going to give you the year that sort of happened in 2000. I have copyright infringement issues, yeah, so I'm very careful. Yeah, the year that sort of happened, 2018, in perspective, in retro perspective, in a sense, with three great men.
Yes.
Amit.
No women.
Abbas. And hi. I'll come to that. And Cyrus. Now, why we have no women here is very simple. Because of the Me Too controversy, which we have to talk about at some point because it was huge in the middle of the year, we don't want to sound biased.
Right.
And the only way we'll be unbiased is if only men talk about it.
I think that's true.
Yes, yes, all in agreement.
That is absolutely it, right? We have to be, you know...
Well, one-sided is the only way to have an argument. I've always believed that, me lord. All right, now we remember this is 12 months of talking here, and you can't just encompass 10, 12 months in 5 seconds.
Right.
We'll do what we can. So please don't write in and tell us you've got this, that and the other, because we have lots of topics here, but we can only go to as many as we can.
Exactly, we can only get to so many.
It's also true of Indian weddings. You can only invite so many people, so just remember.
It depends on the wedding.
Yeah, we invite 10,000, but we could have done 20.
Did you see this? I mean, like, there was a tweet that went viral this weekend. This dude who's a photographer, he invited 35 people to his wedding on his terrace, spent 20,000 bucks, and was like, you know, I mean, like, a lot of people were like, wow, that's so cool, that's so cool. I thought that was really interesting.
I think it's lovely, except the wife shouldn't call him cheap, because you've set a very low bar.
He made the wife cook for the wedding.
So this is the real Me Too controversy that we haven't examined. The sexism and chauvinism that has been allowed to grow in our society.
I think he cooked as well, but his wife actually had her own...
Listen, cutting the kachumbar is not the same as cooking. Really, shameful. Who's the photographer? What's his name?
It was Rizwan something or the other. I don't remember.
I love your research. It's always to the point. Should we go on?
This is not research, man. This was just something that
and
came
you didn't make the top 35,
said.
So why do you care?
Yeah,
it's okay.
That's true.
Yeah. The sad part of it is if you're a close friend of Rizwan's and you weren't invited to the wedding, because 35 is, let's include, say, 15 family members who have to come,
right?
And then maybe 5-6 people who work related who have to come, and then he's got like 10 core people left to call. So there are enough people who must be thinking, bro, I grew up with him. He used to experiment in my house with his photography. You know what I mean? People are gonna feel really bad. 35 is a tough number.
But this was his building terrace,
In his building terrace,
then it's a surprise only 35 showed up.
Have you seen Mumbai buildings?
That's what, if there's a building function, then the whole building turns up.
People
for
just
the,
walk in, This is typical, typical of our country. All right, no more criticizing our lovely country. Let's save that for later. Say 5 minutes down the road. In the meantime, what is our first topic? Are we going in chronology? Are we?
I don't think.
We're jumping around.
Let's jump around for safety, because otherwise, again, you know, people who listen to our show always, and I'm using this word very loosely, anal about things, and they just simply want to point out that hey, you went.
This
from,
happened before
yeah,
this.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
So let's start with the Nasiruddin Shah, the latest thing.
So now we are reflecting from top to bottom.
Yeah.
Descending order, as they say. Right.
So Nasir in an interview said that he feels worried for his children's generation. And the value of life of a cow is now considered more important in India than people.
Yeah.
And this kicked up a Twitter storm, social media storm. But
everything is about context, Abba. So let's give the proper context here. We had this issue in UP where the policeman was slain. Yeah. And immediately the chief minister reacted by saying that you have to be careful about how cows are treated.
Yeah.
And, you know, it actually happened in the same sort of sentence. So I think his point is he's not anti-cow per se. Let's get into perspective. He's just saying that a policeman died and nobody seems to care about it enough and don't want to do anything about it, which is somewhat correct. Well, where are the priorities? What is wrong in a democracy? You should be allowed to call out these things.
Mm-hmm.
And
but because of this, his Ajmer Litfest appearance got cancelled, which kind of proved him right. People jump on you for the smallest
things. Here's the funny part. The organizers stopped him entering there. But the Litfest is all about liberal thought, democratic thought, egalitarian thought, freedom of expression, freedom of mind, freedom of spirit, freedom the Constitution of India has given you, if you bother to read it ever, anyone. So what's really embarrassing for me is it's the whole paradox of actually being part of an art revival sort of thing, because Litfests are growing faster than Indian children.
We've seen this before, right? When Salman Rushdie came at the Jaipur Literature Festival, again, there was a mob showed up at there.
And it's 40 years after the controversy, by the way.
Yeah.
More or less. Salman Rushdie can't remember. Why were they against me?
So I'm somewhat conflicted. I don't really... the Litfest, they should not... are they responsible for their own security in the sense that if you're going to
practical logistical issues?
Yeah,
they're worried that something happens to him and it should not be on their hands.
And not just something happens to them. Are you creating an atmosphere of violence?
Have you seen the movie Tridev? Where he sang that song.
Yes.
Nothing happened to him then. After that atrocious moment in his life, nobody hurt him then. Nobody's going to hurt him now. This is far less painful as far as I'm concerned.
And then Oye Oye was a massive hit, man.
Amit, it turned me off cinema for 2 years.
Really?
Then I worked in Jalba with...
And it was a lift, right? It's from
so much guy.
Made by your neighbor.
Yes.
Rajiv Rai.
Oh.
He was your neighbor. He used to live...
Subsequently got shot also.
Yeah, he got shot, that's right. Yeah. But he lived right next door to you.
Yeah, he did. Nepean Sea Road, actually.
No, he lived on...
Don't give the address on here. I mean, this is not that kind of show.
He lived on the parallel road.
Between Nepean Sea Road and Malabar Hill.
Yes.
So he's in no man's land between India and Pakistan. Let's not say where.
Oye Oye was a lift from a Boney M song.
Of course,
yes, of
course.
Was it Boney M?
I think so, I'm not sure.
I thought it was Gloria Estefan.
Gloria Estefan, Boney M, what difference of 5 degrees? Leave it.
Okay.
Don't fight over that. Let's fight over that. So have we come to consensus on Nasiruddin Shah?
Well, no, not really. Because I mean, like...
Here's what I heard. That all the problems for him always happen on a Wednesday. All the tweets, the Virat Kohli tweet, this tweet. Sorry, it's a bad joke. Sorry, I just want to lighten the moment. We can't go on like this, yeah? What country are we living in? We've got to make it a little funny.
We're living in a country...
You think if the Congress comes to power, this whole cow thing will change immediately? Because the cow thing is a very emotional thing.
I think
whoever's
so.
In power will think, let's use
but
the cow
these
thing.
These are state government issues, right? I mean, like...
Well, Rajasthan, Ajmer is in Rajasthan. Rajasthan is now Congress government. So
right,
what's
so,
the problem?
No, so I mean,
immediately
like,
the Congress should have said, hey, don't worry, Nasir, you're one of our greatest actors. You will come here and we'll protect you.
Did our Maharashtra beef ban not occur under the Congress watch?
You're right. Yeah, I think so.
Yeah, I don't think this is like an irreversible change. Now, they also want to cater to that
correct.
Audience, right? So when they come,
it's all about markets.
It.
If you've got a big market, forget what the issue is. Right or wrong is never important, is it?
See, all of a sudden now, the problem with some of this kind of law, these kinds of laws are, right now, the second that you become, let's say another government comes to Maharashtra and they decide we want to reverse the beef ban. All of a sudden, the positioning against that party becomes, you're killing cows.
So let's put it this way. There's no way that the Congress will come back to power with this slogan, bringing back beef.
It's not happening.
That won't be the slogan.
Not
in Maharashtra,
in the manifesto. At least. Not in Maharashtra, not in Rajasthan. Gujarat, not in Rajasthan.
Hey, but last word on Nasir. We've got so much to talk about.
I don't think it's as bad as Nasir is making it out to be. It's not like everybody is suddenly.
No, his point was about the policeman.
Cows and letting
his point was about
retire.
The policeman and the priority.
No, but him saying I'm scared for my future generation of children of what will happen.
So you're saying he's going to cow publicity a little bit here.
I don't know if it's publicity. It's a little
bit Rishi Kapoor.
Let me ask this.
Yeah.
Do you think the actor is being dramatic?
A little bit, yes.
I still think it all depends on what day.
Okay.
All depends on what day. Yeah.
All right. Since you talked about the Congress coming into power, let's just talk about the major elections that happened this year. The first was, of course, the Karnataka election where the whole push and pull happened for 3 days.
Hmm.
And, of course, the recent...
Oh, well, the best part was the BJP announced victory first. When you say push and pull, that's the best. best part. Mm. See, I don't get that. It's like it happened in the World Cup, Hockey World Cup, right, just now in Bhubaneswar, where they sort of thought they won Belgium, and then the goal was disallowed in the penalty shootout, and so they had to redo the goal. Of course, they actually won again.
Right.
But I mean, for a second, you win, and then they say, no, start again. I mean, that's terrible. It's like you pass an exam, they say, no, actually, you may have failed. Wait, you go to hell. So the BJP won, they started distributing sweets, and you know, everybody started eating. Yedurappa himself was, this is an Indian thing where the guy kills you himself.
Right.
You're worker number 8,486 on the left, and he puts his little two fingers around a mithai and puts it in your mouth, and you lick his fingers, literally. I mean, this thing happens in India.
This was so funny, because in the morning, the reporters who were at the BJP...
with the fireworks going on in the background.
The fireworks going on in the background, and then at 4 p.m., there's a silence taking
deafening
over.
Silence. and we, the neutrals, enjoy all this. Like,
It was genuinely entertaining to see this whole...
I'm finding politics to be the ultimate sport now, because anything can happen, and it's going every way. It's a four innings match all the time. You know, all kinds of things. And changes in team selection policies. So good stuff.
But
good stuff.
A lot of people said that the coalition won't stand, but it's still standing.
It did. But I was in Bangalore just while recording the show, about 22nd of December.
Yeah.
And may I tell you, Kovanaswamy just expanded the cabinet. And I immediately thought of something. Now, when you're a coalition government, and we're probably going to have a lot of them now in India, maybe even at the center for years to come, remember one thing, you have to please everyone. So what's going to happen? Are we going to have more people in cabinet than actual people in the state? Because you're just going to have to say, okay, hello, I want to stay in power. So you please, you take what you want. Make it up. You're Mike Minister. For mics. Finished.
It is, but I think that is a problem.
You don't want to talk about my Kannada accent, which is really not good.
I just want to let it slide.
A discerning listener should say, excuse me, there are many different states, there are many different little layers to these things. All right. Yeah, so great. What a good start.
But this is still better than like the mid-90s. I remember governments used to fall in like 13, 14 days. Every
12 days. Yeah, that was a historic one. Yeah, the Dirty Dozen, they called it.
Yeah, also like the recent elections that happened in Rajasthan, Telangana, MP. Yeah. The resurgence.
The semi-final, as the Congress' supporters called it. I don't understand that. If that's a semi-final, where's the second semi-final? The whole idea of match here is you have two semi-finals. So what's the second one? We're going straight into the final, by the way.
I don't see how you could call that a semi-final, though. I mean,
But the good thing is, again, it's a run of play. You have other parties fighting the big party, and maybe there'll be a resurgence, and good for Indian democracy, I think. Then again, we just discussed cabinet expansions, coalition government, what's going to happen.
Yeah, but I mean, like, is it the end of the world, right? I mean, like, because I mean, like, I was reading something recently that a lot of the biggest kind of moves that happened in a coalition government, right? Economic liberalization happened through a coalition government.
Are we talking India-specific or world?
India. Yeah. I mean, like...
Because there's no question of America having a coalition government. Everybody's resigning.
It's ROD, right? I mean, like, there is no this. But I think the thing with the coalition government is that it moves the acceptable... The amount of policy that's acceptable to a particular party, it expands that. Because now you have to...
It may, but it may also give you what is called a pregnant pause. Mm. You see, there's a pause in governance, which happens also, because ultimately it's a unis bis all the time, and there's, you know, pushing and shoving and checks and balances going to the other extreme, and nothing will be allowed forward. Right. So I don't know.
Both things, right? I mean, like, the amount of acceptable becomes easier, but at the same time, it becomes really tough to do certain things which are...
But the embarrassing part is you may have parties who have contributed one seat.
Right.
Mm. One seat in, say, a business of 200 seats to win or whatever. So out of 200, they've given you one, but they're still in your damn cabinet, and they still have a voice.
Yeah.
And they strut around with chests out and four bodyguards plus two guys on bikes plus six cars behind.
But
one was a relative, was just for some reason.
Is that necessarily the worst thing? I mean, like, if you think about it.
I don't know. What is the worst thing? I mean, we grew up with Congress being the only party, and we all said, listen, someone should challenge them.
Exactly.
Now we're all worried that this other party has gone the other way, gone far too right wing. Maybe we need someone to challenge them.
So
I have no idea.
Compared to the US, right? Republicans, Democrats. I mean, like, that's it, right? There is no other possibility. So there are no
coalitions. There's the Green Party. There's this odd party here and there. Ross Perot made up a party.
Nothing happens with any of these parties.
Nobody attended,
like,
this party. Yeah.
The only exceptions who don't have an R or a D behind their name in the Senate is essentially Bernie Sanders, right, who has an I, and Patrick Leahy, who has an I, right, independent.
Yeah, but it's not impossible that a third party may grow even there. I'm just thinking politics around the world, with the diversity you have in populations, you never know. Look at England. Lib Dems grew. Of course, they died recently, but they'll come back again.
But they were
playing up to one election back. They were definitely playing a very important role.
But incumbency matters in the sense of fundraising and stuff like
that. Now,
who are
we talking about? You're going too fast.
US,
okay.
The incumbency, when it comes to fundraising and stuff like that, matters a lot, because Republicans and Democrats have such a deep kind of infrastructure in terms of what they're doing, right? These have been the two parties for over 100
years. The American
years.
Way is that the famous families, the rich families who are, you know, well entrenched inside the American sort of nation, they put aside money immediately for the party they support. It's all open. There's no question about it.
Yeah.
No, that's Richard William Fawcett III. You know, 17 generations, they all have the same name for some reason. And straight away, you know, 1.7 million to the Democratic cause.
Right, but that's interesting over here as well, right?
Are we doing it openly?
What? No, we're not. We're not doing any, how fundraising happens within a party context.
But when you find government ministers all with, you know, apartments in the same building, you sort of figure it out. Slowly.
That, I guess, is true.
Yeah. All right. We're going off topic. Let's go back. Abbas, yes?
No, I just had one last thing to say. Like, in the 90s, we had HD Devegowda, who became the Prime Minister for a while, right? Yes. He wasn't from the BJP or the Congress. Now, there are rumor mills going that Mayawati will vow for the Prime Minister.
Mamta as well?
Yeah, so we might see that.
But I'm seeing Mamta and Mayawati are still high-profile figures in politics.
Right.
And it will always have some certain amount of charisma. Mm. There's also people you wouldn't have heard of. A compromise, like how Devegowda, beyond Karnataka politics, at that point was unknown. So you're suddenly going to see, who's this guy? Where is he from? And that may be a real compromise. Actually, that's the only compromise that people will accept. If you look at it as adults, when they're sitting around, nobody wants a big name. But your big name versus my big name, that doesn't work.
But that's,
you have to go for a small name.
2014, Modi won because there was this...
No, that's a single party issue.
Yeah.
I'm saying when you come together with five groups of people,
right,
five to seven more, all the regional parties in the south who will support them, etc. You have 10, 12 players on the table.
Mm.
You're going to have to look at a compromise who's not a big player. Because everyone will say, my big player, your big player, have to cancel themselves out.
Right.
It has to be a small player. And that could be a worry because you don't have a natural leader. You don't have a leader who has confidence in himself being a leader. His self-esteem as a leader is low. Think about all these things.
Enough about Dr. Manmohan Singh.
Poor guy. He won't be coming back. Lovely man.
All right, I quickly touch upon, so back in January, the Bhima Koregaon clashes happened.
Oh my God, I was driving from Pune to Bombay.
Wow, that was also this year, huh?
Yeah, that was also this
year. Early in Jan.
Yeah.
We had just finished our, you know, poor people live in Alibag, so we went there to visit all the poor cousins.
Right.
And then on our way back and took the wrong route. And cut a long story longer, it just went on and on and on. And we had no idea, of course.
Right.
The great thing about India, when you're stuck on a highway, the rumors will go on. Country has civil war, government has fallen, China has invaded, all kinds of things.
But nothing ever came of it beyond that.
No, there were
time, right?
Activists who were arrested for that, and they were given harsher sentences than.
The RPI and Dalit guys are on one side, and the Bhim guys on the other side, it's still going on.
Right.
They're calling each other names, they've gone to court, so it'll never go. Why will it end? All these things, firstly, you need a lobby, and then you have to stand up, then ego gets involved, and you can't stop.
Fair enough.
But again, as usual, who'll suffer? Some passing taxi driver, bus driver, motorist, guy crossing the road.
Alright, let's jump.
Yeah.
You want to say something?
I was saying, in football, it would be called offside, but we can't do that in India. You just have to keep going.
Yeah. Oh, you mentioned football.
Good segue for you.
It was like excellent segue.
From Jan to June. Boom.
Yeah, 2018.
We swallowed 5 months.
The FIFA World Cup, France won the World Cup. Were you rooting for France? Did you think they would
win? Not at all. I was rooting for Croatia towards the end because they were
a
country smaller
team
than South Mumbai. And then, you know, like 20 million or 10 million people. And then you're in the final. And course, people would say 1.3 billion. Why aren't we in the final? We weren't in the finals. Forget the final. So I was Croatia was good, but what I find fascinating, we mentioned this before, is how many people in India support the English team, and I'm sure it's to do with the pronunciation of names, which is the easiest. That's all I can think of. There's no other reason.
But
they really struggled with some of the South American names, even though they like the teams a lot.
Right.
You know.
Okay. Right.
It's true.
Right. Do you think if America was big in football, we'd be supporting them? Because I think the UK and America are so good at selling themselves.
The publicity machine thing, the propaganda thing. And pretend not to be propaganda thing also. You know, self-deprecating propaganda. Sometimes the best propaganda. We suck at football. Wow, support them.
No, I think it's also, it's basically the soft power of culture, right? I mean, like, these are the two areas where we get culture that comes to us from primarily.
Language. Commonality of language.
Yeah.
And so many desis living in both those countries. Come on, we're Indians everywhere.
Yeah,
we're running policy. We run IT in America, for example. We own all the sports stadiums in England, at least one, Blackburn. Mm.
Hey, did you hear NBA game coming to India next
year?
Yeah,
two games. Because there's an Indian owner now.
So Vivek Ranadive is the owner of the Sacramento Kings.
Is it Ranadive?
Ranadive.
Yeah.
I mean, that's how he pronounced it. I've heard it. Sacramento Kings are going to be playing the Indianapolis Pacers.
Right. At the Wankhede Stadium?
No, I think NSCA.
I think that would be a better idea. Okay. But is that proper regulation?
No, so it's a
basketball
game is not that basketball courts are not that complicated, right? It's 94 feet by 38 feet or whatever.
But you know, this is India. They may have done it in 92 feet.
Well, you have
Sacramento Kings. If you're coming up, please do a recce. Please check everything. Please measure. Bring your own measuring tapes.
I'm sure they will. I mean, again,
will you go for that?
100%.
Is it by invite only?
Even if it's not.
Can we lie on the podcast? If you love basketball, if you love the NBA, you're interested in Sacramento Kings, you like any of these teams.
De'Aaron Fox and Buddy
Hield. You can go through us.
Yeah, but then are they bringing their proper A team?
They will. So again, you see the point of doing these things, right, where they have these preseason games in other countries like India. They had one. They had like a regular season game in London last year. They have preseason games in Mexico City. They have them in all these places. I think there was one in the Philippines last year. The point of doing this is to kind of make the game more popular in these places. Right,
it's a commercial point to it all, because exactly. Is it growing in India?
It is growing massively in India, and the thing is that
I've just got the ratings for NBA in India. Last Saturday, 7 people watched.
No, I'm sure it was more than
8.
That. More than,
but you said you slept for 6.5 hours.
But I slept in the afternoon. I woke
so you watched
up in
the game
and
then okay.
So my game was Sunday morning.
I
stand
corrected.
I saw Sunday morning.
Sunday morning is Saturday morning in America. Who knows what we're talking about?
It's growing also because, like for example, I didn't know who Shaquille O'Neal was when I was a kid, but now I know because so many comedians use him in their jokes.
No, but he's also a movie star.
He is, yes.
He's
but
so many films,
I only knew Michael
well.
Jordan because he was in Space Jam.
Yeah.
And I knew Charles Barkley again because he was in
and Kareem Abdul-Jabbar, you'd
Kareem
watch
Abdul-Jabbar
Bruce
because he was very hard to find an American with the name Kareem Abdul-Jabbar.
Yeah. But he was an actual kung fu artist. Huh? He trained under really? Bruce Lee as well.
Yeah, yeah. He's Kareem Abdul-Jabbar is one of the most interesting people ever, man. Yeah, so his original name was Lou Alcindor. Mm-hmm. Then from that, he converted his name to Kareem Abdul-Jabbar. He was in the press conference with Muhammad Ali, Jackie Robinson, and one more person.
All the iconic black players.
All the iconic
black broke through the wall.
Who broke through, essentially. Like, just a really, really, really interesting figure. Mm. He is a writer of, like, extraordinary capability.
Really?
Yeah, he's a fantastic writer.
As in graffiti on urinals or an NBA court?
Writer, as in, like, actual writer, non-fiction writer.
What are you saying?
He is a phenomenal figure.
He's very titled. His name will take 3 pages.
He's very well spoken also. I remember Larry Wilmore had him on his podcast the week the Charlottesville protests happened, and he spoke very elegantly and eloquently
would be more like, hey, I'm finishing school, I'm being elegant. Eloquently would be like when you use big words like balderdash,
like Nasir.
That's the biggest word I have. Nasir is very bilingual, he can really fool us. Maybe we don't know what he's saying. Don't be careful.
Fun fact about the FIFA World Cup: this was the World Cup with the most own goals.
So fixed, as they say. Fixed. What do you mean fixed? Yeah, okay, we have to take a break and fix our own show. If you're listening to us sort of live, which is not true, then quickly write in and tell us what we missed in the year, because we went straight to June for some reason.
No, we're jumping around, man.
We may come back to March.
Yes, yeah.
How aware do you think you are of your laws and rights? Do you look up to laws when you are caught up in situations? Do you know what your rights are when you're stuck somewhere bad? Well, here's a show that can help you move an inch closer to being aware of what your rights are. Tune into Know Your Kanoon with me, Amar Rana. This is a podcast meant to answer all your law-related queries. Catch Know Your Kanoon every week on the IVM website or the app or anywhere you get your podcast from.
Back here after the break, our special on 2018. Our whole idea is to put the whole year into perspective. And I think now we live in a world where everybody can't remember last month. Forget, last year.
I know. I'm just looking at this list that Abbas put together. I'm just like, shit, this happened this year. Holy crap, how did this happen this year?
When you mentioned Kareem Abdul-Jabbar in the thing before the break, I was like, what? That was last year, wasn't it? But apparently he retired like in 1986 or something.
Like way back.
79. Give me a year.
Not 79.
82.
I think mid-80s.
I'll keep saying numbers until we get it right.
So at some point
we have the time. 84, 85.
Some point in the mid-80s.
92, 68.
So he was there for, I think, 2 of the Showtime Lakers 5 championships in the 80s.
You don't know we have so much to talk about, and you give us a basketball.
You asked me some questions, man.
So I have 2 minutes. 2 topics cancel Abbas because of this bloody basketball. By the way, why is it basketball, not basketballs? Should you have 2?
There's just 1 ball.
There's
1
but there are 2 teams, so they should have 2 balls.
No,
but
so why isn't it crickets?
It is crickets in Punjab. You play the crickets. Yeah, Abbas, go north. Now, man. Yeah.
Okay, let's quickly move to the stuff that happened in the U.S.
But there's so much happened.
There's
in
so
US.
Much happened.
Palomine got a green card.
I'll try and group the... Who got a green card?
Palomine, Viren.
A pal of yours, okay. So the big thing that happened was the immigration fiasco that happened where children were taken away from the parents at the border.
Yeah.
There are also reports that they were put in cages and...
Well, they were kept away from the parents, cages or not, which is ridiculous, you know. Mm. You actually pull a child away, and I mean, can't understand that. And of course,
it's still happening. Yeah, I think just CNN,
all the left-leaning journals and left-leaning electronic media, they will find all the pictures in the world and play it all day.
No, but this goes beyond left-leaning or right-leaning.
I know,
right?
No doubt about it, but I'm just saying that Donald Trump has to be even more careful, because there's enough people out there just waiting to push things.
But the thing is that just that now he doesn't know how to be careful. He doesn't know
how to care enough.
He doesn't give a shit, right? I mean, like, the guy who just resigned, right? General Mattis. Yeah. The
18th guy who just resigned.
But I mean, like, this guy resigning, you saw his letter, right? Of resignation.
This is the Secretary of the Defense.
Defense guy. His letter of his resignation was that I believe very deeply that we should value our allies.
This was Syria, right? Afghanistan,
this guy resigned in the context of pulling out of Syria, but also Afghanistan at the same time,
which he just announced
right. But his letter of resignation said that I believe that we should be working with our allies, and you clearly don't believe that, so you should get somebody whose beliefs align better to the same as you do.
But they all speak Russian, so that's a problem.
That is a problem, yes.
He doesn't really speak Russian, but he toes the Russian line. So it's very, very interesting that.
But the thing is that, I mean, like, at this point in time, he has lost. There's nobody who has any kind of respect for this guy whatsoever, right?
No, there is. The other basketballer who I don't want to mention, because you'll give a sermon again.
Okay.
The one who goes to Kim Jong-un and, you know, watches cowboy movies.
Rodman!
I don't think Rodman's a Trump supporter.
He's not a Trump supporter. Dennis Rodman.
Kim Jong-un doesn't surprise me. Rodman's a whack job too, man.
Yeah. And once he gives you his endorsement, you know you have to leave politics.
Also, the midterm elections happened, which was, again, kind of like a little bit of a comeback for the Democrats.
Right.
Kind of like our Rajasthan and MP elections.
Well, they won the Congress, right?
They won the Congress,
but the Senate, they're Senate still slightly below par. Yeah. Well, it's something. Yeah, exactly like you said.
Well, at least they got one house back.
But having said that, he's still, people have been saying about his resigning and about his impeachment.
He's going,
it is 2019 literally now, and we're looking at 3 years of reign, right? And so he's passed now. He's in the final stretch. You can't really do anything.
So, I mean, he'll win the 2020 election.
No, I don't know about that. Let's figure out our own world first in 2019, April, May. Then we'll come to that.
But when you say he's going nowhere, you mean for the near future?
You need to have a certain amount, if somebody is to be impeached or you want someone to resign, there has to be some shame behind it.
Also, they can't go for it without really having... I mean, if you look at that whole oral sex controversy, et cetera, with Bill Clinton. I mean, of course, it's sex, which now looks like a really small thing compared to all the other problems.
Yeah.
But if you look at that, you can't take on a president without having a body of work behind you. You've got to say, okay, I'm coming to the wall with this.
Right now, the whole Bill Clinton stuff is going through a whole different kind of like re-examination in terms of how people think about him, right?
Yeah.
Because by that point in time, everybody was...
He got a call back.
I don't know what that means.
He won the next term.
Yeah, he won the election.
Ye sala American ko callback nahi malum.
Nahi, but callback.
I was thinking callback in a comedic sense.
Yeah,
about,
that's
like,
what I was wondering. How does that thing?
Callback. It's called re-election. Re-elected.
Callback is callback.
Okay.
You guys don't speak Americana.
Yes, I don't.
Es la vista, baby. Oh, not allowed. Behind the wall.
So Monica Lewinsky has become this extremely admired writer, columnist, all that kind
on
of stuff.
On that one incident, or if you can call it that, she's still 15 seconds have gone on.
No, but it's not 15 seconds. She completely disappeared. And now she's come back on her own terms.
But
the
book sold really well.
Yeah, but
people read only 3 pages, the detailing of the encounter.
But she is, she's coming across as really super smart. You understand exactly a lot about what was going on at that point in time.
Mm-hmm.
Paula Jones, who was at that point in time looked at completely dismissively, is coming back as a credible.
She wasn't able to push her agenda. If I remember correctly, she was shot down.
No, so at that time, that's what everybody did, right? Oh, this woman is not. She's not.
There were five or six who came out of the woodworks.
There were five or six women who came out at that point in time.
But there was no Me Too movement in America.
There was no Me Too movement at that point. Now, in the context of Me Too, all of a sudden,
it would have been swallowed by the Black Sea.
No, I mean, like, he is not considered a positive figure anymore, right? I mean, like, in that sense.
This is difficult. We need more specifics, we need more details. I'm very worried about slander. The line between being a ladies' man and a charming man, et cetera, et cetera, and being a predator,
right,
and using position of office and power, et cetera, et cetera.
You're a 45-year-old president, you're sleeping with a 19-year-old intern, you've used your position of power. There's no ifs, ands, or buts about it.
I bet you're very, you know, righteous.
I am.
Your standards are very high. Have you met men? Please.
I have. That's the whole thing.
Men are feet of clay. And as you age, the clay goes upwards.
But
trust
if you are using your position at work in a position of power to sleep with women, then that means that there is no...
But if you're in a position of power, you still like to sleep with women.
But then you don't sleep with women who you work with.
Yeah, that's true. But it's easier said than done, you know. But you got to understand
that.
Is he pushing the agenda of, I'm the president, please come and sleep with me? Or is he a lonely figure who can't really get in touch with his wife, whose wife is disconnected from him? And if you've seen that...
That's not a good enough reason.
Let's play a devil's advocate. What kind of Democrats are you all?
Clearly
Republican.
It's not being the devil's advocate. It's being let's right the wrong that he did.
Is it only that because he's in a position of power that these things happen, or is it also because a human being at the end of the day, a man who's lonely, forget man, a man, woman, whatever person,
man who's being lonely will never fly as a good enough reason.
I don't know. Your president doesn't mean you're not human and you lack companionship.
I understand.
Can we hold hands and sing?
I understand that. But
we will overcome.
You cannot mess around with if you are at the top of an organization. You cannot mess around with people who are working for you. That's just how it
is. You know, the sex lives of leaders, if they're ever published across the world, your third world, second world, first world, whatever you want, will be fantastic news for us if we can get the truth.
Well,
so don't judge, lest she be judged.
Stormy Daniels wrote a tell-all book about Donald Trump.
And now she's became a bestseller. She has to pay for legal fees.
Well, that's still in court, I think. Yeah. So she wrote a book with some really detailed...
I think forward is by Tiger Woods.
Is it? I don't think so.
Well, it's just a joke. Yeah.
But she went on to describe what happened with Trump and how his stuff in his body looks, and the book became a bestseller.
But how do we know unless everybody can... You know,
we just have to take her word. I don't want to know.
I want to know. I want this thing played out fully. All right, let's move away. Too much discussion. Let's come to Army too quickly.
Yeah, so Brett Kavanaugh... Have
you thought of it this way? One of the big prizes that you get in cinema is, I think, the Golden Palm or the Royal Palm or something like that, right?
The Palm d'Or. Yeah.
And why can't they take a leaf out of that and instead of jumping on all the women inside if they just use their palm?
Okay.
Pregnant pause and my two wise men.
I just needed to let you. No, we need.
So if there was a manger and we are the three wise men, I'd be thrown out, right? First. Sorry, sir. Please go.
Cool. Let's talk about the Me Too movement. It happened in India.
Before we do, as we record this last week of December, have you guys noticed that it's sort of died down a little bit?
Not really. I don't think so. I don't think it's died down.
Where's Tanushree Dutta? There's no mention of her. What is that film director, the one who got...
There's a 24-hour news cycle.
I can't remember his name.
Who?
The ex-ONM guy who made films.
No, when you said
Queen film. Vishal something.
Phantom Films did get dissolved, right? Yeah. It did have repercussions.
So immediate repercussions, yes. Yeah. But 2 months later, that's it. You know,
But they haven't bounced back either.
Cases, MJ Akbar, Nana Patekar, whatever. Right. All those cases are just going to drag on. Nothing is going to happen. I'm not saying who's right or wrong, because I'm still a little bit out on the edge here. Huh. I'm not very clear about... I don't know how you guys can just make judgment like that. We don't know.
I don't feel
My
like
wife gave me a lecture. You don't know what women are going through this. And I said, but listen, just the law has to be blind. We have to look at it from perspective.
No, but see, law is not the case. Law is not the only thing that applies over here. There is a social acceptance or an unacceptance towards these kinds of behaviors, right?
Yeah, but there's a certain prejudice when you come there with that blanket thing.
I have no problem if MJ Akbar was going around to all the parties that he goes to and hitting on women left and right at those things. I had no issue with that, right? That being a ladies' man, whatever, I have no problem with that. Mm. When he is throwing his attention
and then
on his journalists, right? I have a problem with that. These are two fairly different, and I think this is.
I worked for him at the Asian Age. He never called me to his room.
There you go. Isn't that really the point? Right?
Yeah.
The fact that he never called you to his room. Why is he calling the women in?
Did he? I mean, that's what I'm saying. It's one person's word. No, I'm not saying he didn't.
You tell me this. It's like when so many women come out with this similar story.
Probability is in their favor because of numbers and all that.
Yeah.
But I'm saying we're still passing judgment immediately. We need to hear all sides of the story.
But I mean, nobody is stopping him from telling his part of the story. But I think that on the face of it, some of this stuff is just not okay.
So you guys don't understand. You're both unattractive men. Please just fight for our people someday. Yes.
Well, I mean,
but here's this person with extreme power in his favor. There is no reason for you to...
Again, the whole show has become... We're going to get fired for this. Literally. my only point is, how can you just jump to the conclusion? Like Bill Clinton or Alok Nath or MJ Akbar, and yes, they're all powerful men. How can you just jump to the conclusion that what's driving them is their power? I'm saying sometimes people just want someone to connect with.
But it doesn't have to be... Cyrus, it doesn't have to be that clean. If there is a power equation which is differential, right, where there is a significant difference in that... At that point in time,
You're taking the dots and you're connecting them yourself.
No,
the dots are there, but I'm saying we can't just say for sure. Sometimes someone just wants
Are they denying? Is MJ Akbar denying the fact that you're seeking sexual favors?
Well, he's denied everything.
So then, I mean, like, then that'll come out, in terms of what that is.
All right, let's move on. Just going nowhere. I'm trying to be judge, jury, and executioner, and I'm only getting executioner. So you two guys are just so right-wing, it's scary.
Wow, okay.
When it comes to me too, you're right-wing. There's right-wing to everything, right-wing to everything.
Right now, you're just passing judgment on us, like, instantly.
I'm just saying that we need to look at things from different perspectives. The Rashomonic effect, we discussed this.
Let's agree to disagree.
All right. Jai Hind, as we used to say in the good old days.
Okay, let's move on to the good news. Section 377 was decriminalized.
Correct.
The courts have...
Imagine such a big thing and we actually forgot about it. And life is moving so fast.
Because it seems like it was an anachronistic law that should have been kind of...
Should have, but the poor guys have been fighting for so many...
I know. Yep. So that's why now that it's done, it's like it doesn't feel like...
Good judgment was passed in terms of the words used by the justices, the esteemed justice and justices, the five of them, I think, to explain and to apologize to a community.
Yeah.
To apologize for the atrocities and don't forget what if you have gay friends, what people have gone through. We had Naveen who used to work here and thank God he was open about it and had put his chest out and said, I'll fight for my oppressed people. And, just simple things like, going to toilets and things like that and being made fun of everywhere they go. Mm. You know, when they go to perhaps officialdom and officialdom sneers at them and passes comments and calls them things and all that.
Right.
This is years and years of all that shit. You know, talk about racism, but this form of sexism is as equal to that.
No, it is. It's just as bad. And I mean, like, I'm glad that it's gone. The thing that I come to is that it was just so overdue that celebrating it over and over again just feels like,
I think you guys should be gay for a day. As a part of solidarity.
Okay.
Everyone take one day a year when you're gay.
Okay.
And you say, okay, now I've understood what it is like to be gay and I will now, support the movement or not. If it was a painful experience, I'm just putting it.
I'm actually not against that because then you get to face the kind of ostracization that they face on a daily basis.
Yeah, for your one day in 10
years. Yeah, so at least you get a glimpse. Of
really? Really? Both of you guys, seriously? I mean,
let's go back to basketball. We seem to be better focused on that. Sacramento Kings to come soon.
The point or something like this is about personal freedom, right? Isn't it at the
Absolutely.
End of it? It's about
individual. And also, as you said in the beginning, archaic laws.
Yeah.
Everything. This is true of religion as well. It has to evolve. You can't just go on back and say, okay, 300 years ago, this law made sense. It doesn't make sense today.
It does not.
So, infidelity was also struck down as a crime.
As a crime.
Yeah.
It continues to be there as a sport. So, I mean, please, choose your partner's wife. And here's what I have to say. If you can't handle your wife or your girlfriend, think twice before you take a second wife or girlfriend. I'm talking from a male perspective. Females, I don't know. Females always say that they feel incomplete with one man because we're not able to give them
now you're
everything.
Contradicting your lonely man theory when you're like, if you're a lonely
man. No, my lonely man is about connection. That's not just about man-woman. You need people to connect with to have a life.
Mm.
Because, Aristotle, I think, said that, we're social animals. We can't live, no man is an island.
Right.
Well, we had seven islands and don't want to get into that, Mumbai. But, so I'm just saying, if you don't have a connect, suicidal and depression, thoughts and these kind of things come out of the fact that you're disconnected. All the people who do that are disconnected. They can't connect with people. That's what I'm saying.
Okay.
So I'm just asking you, going back to Bill Clinton, because you dare bring it up, Abbas, you may be the most powerful man, you may have nuclear reactors under your thumb and all that, but at the end of the day, I mean, you have no one you can have a glass of wine with and chat to, because, your lovely dog can't speak, and you're disconnected from your wife, who's the only person you're allowed to be close to in that kind of position that you're in. So, like, he has 10 friends every day, and they, play darts. Or did they?
Okay.
I can see y'all are disinterested in my lecture.
Bill Clinton wrote a novel this year with James Patterson. It was called The Accident. No, not The Accidental Prime Minister is Sanjay Baru's book.
Yeah, well done.
It was a thriller set in the White House. It was a very trashy book. Yeah.
Is there an oral
James Patterson wrote it, right?
James Patterson and Bill Clinton. Yeah, I mean, so then Bill Clinton.
Patterson doesn't write James Patterson's books. You know that.
That's
right?
True.
Okay, James Patterson is also the Aussie fast bowler who's.
Not Patterson. Patterson.
Patterson.
Yeah.
James Patterson. He's the guy who wrote those. He's written like he writes like 10 books a year and most of them are written by other people. He just kind of puts his name on
them. The President is Missing. Yeah, that was the title of the book.
Wow.
Excellent.
He's best known for that Along Came a Spider.
That's his book, which he didn't write.
Back then he used to
write. Did he win a book for anything he didn't write?
No, he used to write back then. But then once he got a certain amount of fame, at that point in time, he stopped writing.
Okay, we've digressed again back to Bill Clinton and America and NBAs. We've got to go back to India.
Yeah, let's. You want to go back to India? Okay.
No, whatever. Whatever's on your agenda.
Let's touch on tech for a little bit. Mark Zuckerberg was involved in the whole Cambridge
Analytica. The apology in Senate.
He testified against the the Senate.
Didn't that go on for days?
It went on for a fairly long time, right?
Yeah, I saw part. You saw that.
I saw a lot of it.
We discussed it on an episode of
For Amit, it's a very personal. You know, for me, Bill Clinton, for him, it's this whole Zuckerberg and him standing there with these morons asking him questions.
Well, the problem
there were some moronic questions.
So there were moronic questions coming from the parliamentary side, but Zuckerberg's also not the person to answer those questions. So the insistence that Zuckerberg come and answer these questions or
make a guy stand there.
No, but that's just it, right? These are not the right...
It's like a punishment. Like if you were in class and the teacher puts you in a corner and says, now I'll, you know...
I wouldn't call it... I take the analogy more like something like...
Look at the body language, Amit. Uh-huh. He's standing there with his hands to the side of his hips.
Right.
And he's listening to people talk and he can't do anything. You know, he has to keep buffering or moving.
He does. But also the thing is that, they're ignorant people on the side of the Congress. Like all congressmen when it comes to technology...
All those who ask questions were 80 and above.
They're all ignorant about this stuff. They don't understand this stuff.
They haven't heard of television.
That's what one of them asked him, how do you make money? And he's like, we run ads, Senator. Like it was just the most obvious thing.
A couple of times he dropped his guard and was a bit sarcastic. I saw that.
But it came across that way because the other questions were
It's also 2 hours, 3 hours into it. Your guard. It's
you
normal.
Get a little irritated right, when you're dealing with people asking you really dumb questions. That also
haven't you been to the post office?
I think the more important thing is that this insistence, right, that the questions must be answered by the CEO. Right, it's kind of foolish.
But then isn't he the captain of the ship?
Yeah, exactly.
He is the captain of the ship. But if you want answers about specifics, right? Yeah. If somebody wants to, let's say in our company, right? Mm. Somebody wants to ask, hey, what happened on episode XYZ of The Seen and the Unseen?
Right.
Am I the right person to ask, or are you the right person to ask?
But in the hierarchy of things, my answer would be expected to go through you, right?
So Amit, what you're saying is then you give me a bench of 7 people
who run
the organization.
Let me have all of them with me so I can
finance
report
head,
them,
sales
right?
head, marketing head, new business head, admin head, HR head, PR head, whatever. Put them all together and put this guy as well there. And then you say, okay, let's go for it. So he can point and say, Jeff, now you take this one.
Mm. And this is a company that is by revenue probably like 5,000 times bigger than us.
Fuck that.
So, I mean, like, by headcount, it's like so...
Let's not kid around. This has put America back on the map. Oh. This whole internet revolution has put America right back just when, you know, perhaps they were facing a bit of a competition from the rest of the West. Mm. They went right back with these guys. So, suddenly you're shooting yourself in the foot, if you ask me, also, in a sense. Mm. Because this is really America's strongest point, the fact that they are innovative, and always going ahead.
They don't get it, right? That's the problem, right? I think this is...
China does. They're starting their own Google.
China gets it. I think the Indian government... government doesn't really get it, right?
I think we are torn between the Chinese way and the American way. We're somewhere in the middle.
So, no, we did the thing this year where we limited the number of WhatsApp forwards. And
So
that fake news doesn't get spread. Right?
No, it's still you can't.
Can I use the word call back?
You can. But I think you still cannot use do more than 5 forwards. 5 people you cannot forward to at a time.
Yeah. And
I do?
There is a forwarded word that comes to tell you that this is happening.
You can take one message and forward it, and then forward it again. And
but
forward
manually
it again.
Forward
but
it.
Yeah, you can't go like...
As long as you're doing some work. Yeah. You can go on forwarding all day.
It's about creating some friction. But I think the bigger problem over here and...
Can we quickly digress from there for a second to this week where the opposition attacked the BJP for having all these machines, what is the right word to use? These agencies, let's say, to look into your various computers, ways to look into your internet data and sort of catch you. And then, of course, BJP saying that it was already there from the UPA government, some of them. So the idea and philosophy comes from before. Yeah. Now, who are we kidding? Because back in the West, China, wherever, Korea, it's already there as well. The big brother watching you sort of
depends
phenomenon.
Depends on where, right? And depends on how and depends on what context.
After terrorism hit the world in a big way, let me be honest here, I think every country has allowed themselves a little bit of leeway here. And of course, I don't want to know about who's screwing who, but I'll find out by mistake. What I want to know is if you're going to become a jihadist. What I want to know is if you want to topple the government.
There are some countries where things are completely black and white, right? China, Russia, UK. Right over
so
here.
So in a way, China and Russia are the more.
When you say black and white, in what sense?
Stop it. China and Russia are more trans. This is what he's saying. Here's again another paradox, beautiful one. China and Russia are actually less hypocritical in a sense because you know where you stand with the government.
Even the UK.
You do. Yeah, UK. But UK has actually told them that
UK
we are watching
also,
every
are,
inch
are
of the street and
everything.
Of your computer. Yeah.
So I mean, like you know, there is a in certain cases that is there, right? Places like the U.S., Canada, Sweden. Sweden is actually the paragon of privacy in some ways, right? So it depends on like kind of this, right? In the U.S., in Canada, in
they pretend to be looking the
France,
other way.
Germany. No, it's
giving
not
you
that.
Privacy,
it's like
but they actually do look.
There is a process in terms of how you go about looking. So data is available.
Now, that's where the argument lies in this process. My question to you is, as two concerned citizens, as you are, so where do we draw the line now? Forget BJP or Congress, whoever the fuck is the government. Who draws the line as to what is invasion of privacy and where I feel that I'm being molested by my own government?
So privacy will always be compromised for security. That's just, I just take that as a default.
Look, so I'm saying they're looking for words, for example, they're looking at, you know, you and I may be making jokes.
Right.
A lot of times it's red herrings or they're making jokes, you know, I don't know.
I don't know. It's honestly, it's not a simple answer, right? I mean, like, we live in a complicated country. We live in a country where people can.
If you were the government, what would you do?
I really don't know. I mean, like, because see, for example, WhatsApp forwards and stuff like that, right? I would be, the way the government does insist on, the government is trying to insist on this, I kind of agree with them, right?
No, no, but see, they are talking about terrorism and anti-national activities, right? But that's just the way to get in. Once you're in, you have information which you can use personally.
Which is why I think what the
whether
US
Whether it's
does,
about the opposition, whether it's about financial issues, for your own personal gain, there's so many things you can do.
So I like what the US does in some ways, right? There is a judicial oversight in terms of what you can and cannot get. If you go beyond that judicial oversight, which happened, right? It happened in, like, I think under Bush and early Obama, where they were going beyond what judicial oversight was actually giving them the ability to do. I think that's the way to kind of approach this. There must be judicial oversight in terms of when you want to collect.
So let me ask you a question. Is it okay for the government to snoop in and stop Nasir tweeting? Or
They should not be able to do that at all, right? I mean, like, freedom of expression is a different issue altogether. If you are looking at data from an investigative perspective, that makes a certain amount of sense. But you cannot do it from
it's
the
never
perspective.
Gonna happen. See, who's going to draw these lines and say this is okay? This is
but that's why you need judiciary involved, right? That's why you want judicial action.
It's a complicated world.
I
can't understand how this is going to work. Either you look or you don't look. Yeah. And if you're looking, then tell us you're looking like in Russia. In which case, you'll be careful and Abbas will send me a between the lines joke using so-and-so reference, right?
Yeah, sure.
Like, Brandy, you said you were telling me about some roadie.
Yeah.
But you meant a political leader.
Exactly.
And I didn't know who you're talking about. And only later I found out he was talking about somebody called Ajit Jogi. Okay. Oh, you thought somebody else. You thought somebody else. Yeah. Okay, right.
But just a one
good setup, Amit. You walked into it.
Do you think that these like the Zuckerbergs and the Elon Musks, who till a couple of years ago were
two
seen,
different, very
were
different
seen,
personalities.
No, but they were seen as these futurists or people
who are great
people. Now they've kind of fallen from grace.
No, I think they are great people. You can, especially Zuckerberg. I think you can't stop that part of what they've
even
done.
The Twitter CEO Jack. He also got into a bit of a trouble this year when he said that he can't
comment. So, but coming back to
not the comment, he got in trouble over the caste thing, no?
The caste thing, as well as he's not taking down right-wing extremists and Nazis, and he said,
But then again, make up your mind. Is it a free world or not?
That's also sites like Facebook and...
the moment you start telling me that this is not allowed, it's your philosophy, right?
Yeah.
So in actual democratic thought, there's nothing right or wrong, but thinking makes it so, in a sense. So in that case, how can I stop anyone saying anything?
The solution
so either it's a free forum or it's not.
The solution to bad speech is more speech. It's not to restrict speech. I've always believed that very strongly.
Yeah, I just think that, that's just encouraging it in many ways.
I just think it's become like the Skynet situation where the creation has become bigger than what they expected it to be.
I don't know about that, right? I mean, like, if you...
Yeah, so how could they control the size of the balloon in a sense? And, they didn't know. You're right. How would they know for sure?
They wouldn't, but at the same time, I mean, like, so what is the problem over here? Ultimately, something like WhatsApp forwards about child lifters.
Right.
These are creating actual harm, right? Someone saying that this
pedophiles are very active on the internet, for example. All right. So that's the bad which comes with the good.
Right.
When you do.
So there is that, right? But I think something like Facebook or a Twitter or something like that, what is the worst that's happening away? People's feelings are getting hurt. Right.
Beyond that, you're worried about...
I mean, I don't know, man. I think that if somebody's feelings are getting hurt, then, I mean, like, the solution to that is to explain why that is the case. Or, I mean, like, I don't feel like
I
that's
think it's
restriction.
It's oversimplifying it. Like, for example, when Twitter was created, we never expected that politicians will have verified accounts and they'll make official statements through Twitter, which will then become...
And then the Pakistan Prime Minister is all about Twitter.
Yeah.
Take Twitter away from him. Every president. Yeah. It's all about that. But, guys, this is the most serious discussion ever, and I'll never listen to it myself. Personally, I'm just cool. Take it off. Take it down now.
Let's touch upon memes. The things that went viral. Rahul Gandhi hugged Narendra Modi in the parliament during the no confidence motion.
Yeah, it was lovely. Lovely moment. Thought he caught the Prime Minister off guard also.
Yeah.
Yes, he did.
But hugging is more North Indian thing anyway, isn't it? If you look at it culturally in India, the more north you go, the more hugging happens.
That's true. The north you go, so it's more touchy-feely. Like, south, they're very...
They don't even like you, but they hug you anyway. Yeah. It's lovely. You come to a wedding, Sharma ji, kaise ho? Ha, kaise ho? Tuck, 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 tuck. Then over your shoulder, they say, kaun hai, bhai?
Speaking of memes, did you see Elon Musk? And speaking of Elon Musk, we just spoke about, he retweeted or he tweeted some Bajirao Mastani thing.
Yeah. I didn't see this.
He tweeted some video that with Ranveer Kapoor, and then obviously... The rest of India.
Okay, Ranveer Kapoor or Ranveer Singh and Ranveer Kapoor? Ranveer because they're two Ranveer different, Ranveer three different Ranveer people Ranveer that you mentioned.
The meme of Elon Musk smoking pot on Joe Rogan's podcast also went viral.
Yeah, but see, my problem with him is not all that. My problem with him is he seems to have got caught in his megalomania, which after some time, in the way he talks and conducts himself in the last 2 or 3 years, there's been a sharp decline in behavior.
Yeah, that's what. Yeah.
Okay, which is not the exact same as Zuckerberg. I think Zuckerberg is caught by bureaucracy, by a lot of people advising him wrong. But this guy's behavior is like that guy who's hit the big time and doesn't know how to deal with fame.
Yeah, I think Zuckerberg is dealing with actual issues. Policy issues,
which
right?
Which
I
mean, tough.
Like, and they're not that easy, tough. Right? Yeah. I mean, like the Cambridge Analytica thing, right? I mean,
really?
Like,
but technically, they just went after him, you know?
And it's a tough answer, right? Because I mean, like at that point in time, when Cambridge Analytica stuff happened, Facebook was a platform. Facebook was not about.
But that is their philosophy. Is they're just a platform?
No, it was about
it's
building.
Like a stage.
They were now. What is the case is that Facebook controls a lot of the stuff on their own, right? In terms of how people interact with it. In the earlier part of this decade, like 2009 to 2012-13, Facebook
was a platform.
The idea was build apps on top of Facebook so that people will come and use.
So in a way, that's a smart thing to do because you're distancing yourself from what happens.
It is.
You're saying I'm giving you a pitch, you play cricket here.
Right.
But how you play cricket is your fucking problem after that. Sorry, that language is not allowed.
No, it's allowed now.
It's allowed. I retract. I call back my phone.
So it's a tough kind of this to figure out.
No, I just want to distinguish between the two because I think Elon Musk needs psychiatric help maybe because he's a changed man while the other guy is just getting buried in a lot of problems. Mm-hmm. Slightly different issues.
Some of the stuff that Elon Musk did this year is kind of insane, right? I mean, like, he knows he is a guy who has run multiple public companies, right?
Yeah, yeah.
You cannot go out and tweet something like, we are going to go private. You can't go out and do that with a stock price.
Yeah.
And then
you can't blame pot for that because your thinking is more clear. I wouldn't know, but you guys do it, so you would know. Yeah.
Okay.
Silent. Nobody argues. Bro, we're running out of time. Let's get on with the year.
A few quick ones. Rafael deal. Thoughts?
Rafael, Well, that's Congress is going to keep the punching. That's going to be a bag they're going to punch into.
But now the government has got a clean sheet.
Government, is it the government giving the clean
from
sheet?
The courts.
I don't want to point fingers because we have a system in place, but you know, it's a little difficult. But they will use that because in the public eye, they have smeared the government's name a little bit. And in the public eye is where your pronouncement is going to come April, May. So this is definitely one thing they're going to use. Will they overuse it? Have they overplayed their hand? Is it boring by the time you come to April? I don't know. But I think they've done well with it so far. Now they've got to figure out if they're going to really take on the BJP come April, May. Pan India, not just specifics of across India, but pan India, the issues that are going to count. And this will be one. So they have to, I think, pace themselves out because they might run out of steam.
Yeah, that's true.
Statue of Unity inaugurated this year.
I want to go, but it's too high and I'm scared of heights. But apparently, it's not even, you have to go out of Ahmedabad. It's a whole day will go in all this.
Really?
And you can't park your car nearby. So only poor people will enjoy it. Because if you're one of those guys who wants to go in style, you'll have to go park your car far away, then find your way there, and it just goes on forever. Better to take a helicopter and do a little circle around Ahmedabad and you'll get to see it. Perhaps from closer.
Yeah, probably.
Is that allowed or will they shoot you down?
I do not know.
Why don't you guys do it so I can find out?
Okay.
Sure.
Okay.
Jamal Khashoggi's assassination.
And here's what the tragedy here is that everything just went back to normal after a couple of months. Because they're too powerful a country. They still have the oil. They still have the money. Yes, America needs them. They need America. And end of the day, it's all about that. So here's the point. Your morality, what you do, your ethics, they are always going to be secondary to the matlabiness of life.
Yep.
How much
to
are
the
you?
Matlabiness.
The matlabiness of life. You're now talking to a poet.
Countries do not have permanent friends. Countries have permanent interests.
No, and the way, because of the internet and the television today, the way the shouts happen across, you know, about you murdered this guy and across the, you know, Canada, of course, a few countries put their money where their mouth is. But end of the day, I think, you know, the association of Saudi Arabia and America is safe.
Yep. Yeah, true.
That's the way it is.
Allahabad was changed to Prayagraj. Many places which names were changed.
Yeah, and I can think of every single UPI going and calling it Prayagraj. For sure, yeah.
I think we've all been clear about where we stand on these name changes.
That's true, yeah.
I'm changing my name to Chuth. I think that'll work. Yeah. I can save people time.
Virat Kohli was on the number one
speaking
in the ICC rankings in 2018.
He's got such a bad name, bichara. I'm still a big fan of Virat Kohli simply because I've watched this topsy-turviness of Indian audiences. When you have a Sachin Tendulkar, he's too introverted, doesn't talk enough, holds back his emotions. When you have a Dhoni, he's too straightforward, but you know, he's again too quiet and we're not able to see what he really
Ganguly
wants.
Ganguly
is too arrogant and rich, and you know, he's above cricket, he owns it or something. Now you have this guy who puts his heart on his sleeve and you say, oh, he's too much of a... You know, I think these guys are just being who they are and we should just accept it and end it. It's just a sport. It's just a game.
Yeah, I don't think it matters that much.
Yeah, to take it to the extent of a whole India giving their opinions about whether he should raise his finger or arm or leg, who cares?
All right, four very high-profile weddings took place this year. Priyanka Chopra, Deepika Padukone, Meghan Markle and Isha Ambani.
Yeah, but you only mentioned the females, which tells me Too has really hit you in a big way.
Because they were the
male, they're male partners. How dare you? That's double sexism. What the hell? Oh. Yeah, so here's one thing we have in common. We three were not invited to all four weddings.
Yeah, that's
true.
Okay.
We're not invited good to go. Move on. Next.
Sanju was the highest grossing Indian
film. I cannot believe this is true. Yeah.
Why not?
It's a decent film and all that, but I just thought there were bigger sort of banners. And
which, I'm trying to think. Right?
Yeah, which other film?
Stood out this year? Like, Andhadhan stood out for me as a
again, these films are released in more cinemas. You have to remember that.
Yeah, exactly.
With the A-grade stars. No disrespect to Ayushman. Yeah. Kurana, but his name is so long that you know, come watch the film.
No, but this was such a meta thing, like a superstar playing a life of another superstar directed
also
by...
Also, Sanjay Dutt fans and Hirani fans, they go to watch it 4 or 5 times because it's like a cult film for them.
Yeah,
so these
true.
Make up the numbers as well. I studied this with Rajiv Masal, my good friend.
Yeah.
And we wear the same shirt size now, 56. Ab Tak Chappan. You've seen the film. Also, the Prime Minister talks about it all the time. So for me, personally speaking, I am taken a little, I didn't believe, honestly, that Sanju would be number one. Yeah. But I thought it would be one of those appreciated films. I didn't think it would be in terms of finance.
In terms of box office,
But this Hirani is too good, man. This guy has never failed.
Yeah.
He's the guy we should all get in touch with for our podcast.
Yes,
Raju Hirani, here's a heart plea from all of us. Will you direct our podcast for maybe 6 months?
In a year, which had a Rajinikanth film and a Salman Khan film.
Yeah.
Two Rajinikanth films and a Salman Khan film.
One Salman Khan.
What Salman Khan movie was there?
Race 3.
Which had some of the best dialogues ever written. But that also did well, huh? Money-wise.
It did well, but not as well as Sanju.
Yeah.
Interesting. How was 2.0? Anybody
2.0,
see it?
I did. Yeah, you I did? Liked it. Yeah, really? I thought it was on par with any Transformers film.
Okay.
Yeah.
Oh,
like not real story, but as far as machines kicking machines, it was.
Age of Ultron was which year?
Proof 2015.
Yeah.
Oh shit.
This year was Infinity War.
Sorry, girls. Uncle Cyrus going back into the cave. Wake me up in 2019. Thank you.
Okay. Lastly, Black Panther was the highest-grossing Hollywood film, and the Oscars have now added a popular film category, which they'll be awarding in 2019.
So, one sec. Black Panther finally wound up making more money than Infinity War did.
Okay. Now, you guys have not picked up here the absolute arrogance. The absolute arrogance and reverse snobbery of this whole movement. Oh. You put out a popular film segment to say, okay, this is a fucking film which made lots of money, but we all piss on it.
Oh.
Right? Because obviously the best film will be far away in terms of style of film from popular film.
Oh.
So I like the idea, but I think it'll always be like the stepbrother film.
Okay, so let's ask the question. What is the best movie you saw this year?
There was this film called First Reformed by Paul Schrader. It starred Ethan Hawke.
Yeah.
That was a very good film. It was about a priest questioning his faith.
I saw a 4-minute film called Dungeon Wars. It's pornography, but really good stuff. Really good stuff.
4 minute?
Yeah.
Or is it a longer film and you just saw it?
No, I'll tell you what.
Minutes.
I have a problem with time and I watch pornography because I live with lots of people. So I try to keep everything to 5 minutes and under. Okay? Because I want to see the end. You may not understand, but it's all about the end in porn, not so much the beginning. Sometimes the beginning can be very boring. Have you seen, they have shots of women or men walking for hours and then they, you know, outside. So I've seen a porn which started, you know, somewhere in the beaches of Florida.
Okay.
And by the time they reached the house, which could have been anywhere in Matunga, it was like, you know, 15 minutes of walking and chit-chat. And the guy had an Italian accent and the girl had some other accent. You know, so they found two tourists on the beach and, you know, let's chat. Why are we discussing this?
You brought it up.
You guys, mind space. It's all about mind space.
What
Anything
about you,
left?
Amit?
Best Hindi movie, Andhadhun.
Okay.
Best American movie or English movie. I like The Post a lot.
Okay. That came out last year.
Did that come out last year? Okay. Are you sure?
Yeah, because it was nominated for the 2018 Oscars.
No, but I
Oscars.
Think it came out in India in this year only.
I don't think it came out last year.
But since the word is post, you can do it post as well.
That's fine.
I think we have to do AMAs because we've gone really long on this one. So, sorry, we've tried to do as much as we can this year.
Yeah.
Too many things happen, not our fault. AMAs coming up.
Hello, 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 everybody. Welcome to another great week on IVM Podcast. If you're not following us on social media, please make sure that you do. We're IVM Podcast on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. Like I mentioned last week, on Instagram, we have a bunch of interesting content coming up. Make sure that you check it out. You'll really enjoy that stuff. On the 100th episode of The Seen and the Unseen, Amit Verma's guest is economist Shruti Rajagopalan. They're going to answer some listener questions and look back at the year and look ahead at the next year. On Geek Fruit, Tejas and Dinkar talk about how the new animated Spider-Man movie, Into the Spider-Verse, might just have given us the best version of the character yet. On Pesa Vesa, Swapnil Bhaskar, co-founder of Goldwise, talks to Anupam about setting financial goals and how you can achieve them. On Know Your Kanoon, Amber helps us understand the rights and powers of traffic officials and how they function in India. Last week, IVM Likes released its 100th episode. Listen to this celebratory episode as Janam, Abbas and Surbi deep dive into their top picks from the year 2018. Once again, thank you everyone for sending in emails and voice notes talking about their favorite moments from the show. We really appreciate that. And with that, let's continue with the show.
If you have any questions for Cyrus, write to us on Facebook, Twitter, or Instagram. Or you can send an email to whatcyrussays@gmail.com.
All right, back here with the AMAs for 2018. So we've selected the very best. Okay, we have only four, but selected.
All right, Samir Kamra asks, apart from Singapore, which is the country you would want to visit in 2019?
One thing, I have lots of issues, as you probably guessed. One is I need direct flights. Direct flights for me.
Thank you.
Direct flights for me is very important.
I think more important to me is more than direct flight.
I don't enjoy the whole process of traveling if it goes on and on. You know,
the final destination should not be more than an hour and a half, 2 hours away from the airport.
And that's another thing. More than from the airport again to drive. Yeah. What the hell is this?
So I don't mind a one-stop flight, right? I don't mind if I have to go somewhere and then go there.
See, but I don't blame Christopher Columbus now. Because when he reached wherever he reached, he was like, forget it. This is going to be India. Goodness. I can't do this again. Yeah. But sir, it's not India. It's somewhere near what they call America. No. It will be India as far as I'm concerned because I'm not going back the other way.
But do you have places on your checklist?
I think I want to go to Eastern Europe. I'm a big, you know, I want to go to Macedonia.
Okay.
I want to retrace my ancestors' steps. I won't come back to the Indus. I'll stay in Macedonia. I heard great things about Zagreb and places like that. Yeah. So, you know, the whole East, Croatia, Macedonia, that sort of belt I would like to see. But where's the time?
Do you always vacation with your family or do you take solo trips as well?
I try other families, but it's not that easy. Sometimes the wives are very demanding. You know, they want all kinds of things like walks on beaches is actually a thing. I thought it's just something you say. But people actually walk on beaches, hold hands and say, let's walk into the sunset. I'm like, are you crazy? It's 4 now. Sunset's at 6:30. From Pacific, we cross to Atlantic. We can't do this shit. But I got to warn you about women, guys, quickly. Hmm. Lovely as they are, sometimes their demands are things which you cannot in your imagination understand. Forget in reality. So be very careful. Long walks in the moonlight coming soon.
All right, Mangalam.
Start at 4.
Mangalam Malu has asked your best memory
Mangalam
of this.
Mangalam Malu, friend of the network, anchor at CNBC.
Oh, of course.
Yes.
He's asked, what's your favorite memory of the year?
I think a friend of mine was very drunk when I went to walk the dog at 6 in the morning, and he came home and in the neighborhood. And fell out of the car and everything. And I was amazed because that was me 10 years ago. And I was so glad it wasn't now. I helped him out. You know, I had that look in my eye, like, you know, which only a fellow, the empathy only comes when you've done it yourself. Yes. Otherwise, it's always like, oh God, what's wrong with him?
Yeah.
Helped him back home and stuff. That was a lovely memory. It wasn't me this year. Thank God.
Abhishek Trivedi has asked, what are your top 3 events that happened in 2018?
Okay, I got parking in Arimon Point at 9 in the morning on one. We had gone for a meeting. I got at about 9:30. I got parking. Not paid parking. I found a spot and I just
on
parked
the road,
it.
Yes,
on the road. And it stayed there for an hour. That was one great moment. The second is, for me, the greatest moment was when they stopped me urinating because the Prime Minister was going back home.
Okay.
So he was going to the airport from Churchgate or wherever. And at Worli, which is near Mela restaurant, as you turn towards the sea faces where I pee a lot.
Okay.
Right? They have my poster up. Brocha saab, 2 baje, 3 baje, 4 baje. I come there to pee. And as I got out, the cop is telling me, no, you can't go inside. So I said, I can't use the shulab. I can't pee. He said, no. Pradhan Mantri ja rahe. So I said, I don't understand the correlation between him traveling and me urinating. What? So is it disrespectful to urinate when he's traveling, when he's in motion? What? That was huge for me as well.
This is uncanny because the next question is about peeing, Cyrus.
Go on, ask me.
Anuj Sharma has said that you've mentioned the story of peeing next to Bill Clinton twice on the podcast.
Many times.
Yeah.
It's a true story.
So he asks, who are the other people you'd like to pee next to?
I didn't want to pee next to him. Please, Anuj, you understand, I don't know, this anxiety while urinating a lot of men have, I'm one of those. I'm not happy with sharing the pee moment.
There are men who come and say, oh, I did a show in Bangalore just 2 days back, and some guys, they're all doctors, by the way, and they come into the urinal, and one guy says, hey, let's have a selfie. And he sort of took it while we were peeing. You know, so these are things that I'm like, is that where we are now? But I got to tell you, I'm not happy with, I like to pee alone. I want to be in my zone when I'm peeing. And I know lots of men prefer that way. But for some reason, there are also people who feel unhappy and left out, and they connect only when they pee. Mm. So that's the time when they feel the most garrulous and, you know,
anybody who thinks
friendly.
Of urinating as a communal experience.
Yes. Why? Oof.
Okay, so the last one I'm reading is not a question. It's actually a fan mail that has come to you from Chuck Don.
Chuck Don.
Yeah. And
let's give him reverb. Chuck Don.
He says, big hello from Dubai. I have been waiting to write to you for a year for a year now, and was waiting to reach the latest episode.
Wi-Fi stopped? 1 year.
I don't know if I was happy to reach the last episode or glad that I could now write to you, because he binged everything.
Oof.
He says...
Can you tell me the truth?
It's possible.
The only person who would do that is my mom.
No, we have, dude, we have, we don't have an insignificant number of listeners now. Literally dozens of people listen to this show.
We're growing. NCP, eat your heart out.
Cyrus, we last met.
Bit cruel.
The mail is still on.
Sorry. Go on.
Cyrus, we met last when you were hosting the Miss India pageant in Pune.
And it was 2001 or something.
Yeah, I think the Lara Dutta year. I have always been a big fan. You and Sachin is what my generation grew up watching. And then Sachin's retirement made us feel old. It's great to see you in action. You have yet again...
I thought he'd go the other way.
Good to see you in action. You have yet again raised the bar for funny. And I find most... he's trying to say you're the funniest among the current lot. You are undoubtedly great at your craft. And most importantly, a kind and compassionate soul.
At least keep birds.
Please keep making episodes, as Cyrus says. Make sure that the show never stops and keeps on going forever.
God, you're crying, Abu.
And he's actually...
Do you want a hug?
He sent a picture of his dog called Thor. Sweet. It's a...
His dog called Thor? It's like a shepherd, but could be a husky. Or could be a mix.
It is a German shepherd. He's written
a beautiful looking fellow.
So, yeah.
I wish we could show that picture. That would elevate our show.
Yeah, we can add it.
Yeah. Imagine if I can do parts. It's not the cows, but the dogs would be really happy.
I'll tell you what. You know what? On the day that this show goes out, let's put the dog a picture up on our Instagram.
Sure. Yeah,
we'll do that. So then that way
Thor,
people
Thor.
No, see, it's a Scandinavian German
what
shepherd.
I'm doing right now is I'm plugging the Instagram account, which is IBM Podcasts.
So people should follow that. Can you show me how to do that?
You don't post your Instagram at all.
He's got two pictures on Instagram. Yeah. Somebody was just asking him about him.
No, listen, I've got this lady who's coming in. Let the New Year start, and she's going to now guide me. And we met her.
Okay.
Sonali, at the thing we did.
Oh, yeah. Right, yes.
So hopefully, you know, we'll be able to streamline it a little bit and figure out a certain discipline.
All right.
Of how to do these things. The main thing is I just can't take pictures and don't like Kunal does, you know.
Yeah.
You have to have that patience.
No, but Kunal is a food guy, no?
Kunal actually is a teenager. No, Amit, he likes taking pictures all the time.
Yeah.
I don't know, our poster of that TV show we did, and he stopped the car and took a picture. So he's like a teenager. His behavior is like a teenager.
Okay.
I'm still a caveman.
But,
I'm,
see, I think he enjoys the validation that he gets through social media.
Does.
You don't really give a shit about it.
I wish I did. I'm trying to.
Yeah, so start thinking about that.
Yeah, I know.
Start getting that dopamine hit.
Because I have a revenue like. I like revenue. So I'm trying to think
exactly,
of it like that.
That's what I'm saying. Yeah. Dopamine hit. Yeah. Think of that dopamine as a kind of this, no?
I also get off on people not liking me, no? I think I'm enjoying that more. The other day, last story for the year.
Yeah.
So when, there was a gym in the hotel I was in. I won't mention Lalit because it's, you know, say that in Bangalore. Lovely gym. And there's a lady, 65-year-old woman with black hair, as many women have black hair at 65, God knows how. And she was doing this real silly stretching and rubbish that they do in gyms. And I was lifting relatively heavy weight for what is called a Romanian deadlift from the floor. And of course, the weight sort of slips out of your hand and hits, and the thudding sound comes and all. She looked at me in this passive-aggressive manner. I think she would have killed me. Just that one look. So I did it again. And the second look, her teeth came out. You know, like fangs and stuff.
I thought dentures.
No, dentures, the works. They all started slipping and falling into her hands. And she gave me this terrible look. And I was thinking, you know who the aggro person here is? Not me trying to lift these heavy weights and throw it around. But this person is wasting her time stretching. This is the irony of our country. The wrong people are doing the right thing. And the right people are doing the wrong thing. We've got to mix the races a little bit here. Anyway, we have to say something.
Expectations for 2019.
Exactly. Amit, you go first.
Expectations for 2019? Podcasting is going to become the biggest thing in the universe.
It's the most fun job.
Yeah.
And if you can get paid well for it. Yeah. And I look at politicians. No, they mastered a thing where they don't do much either.
Yeah.
So why can't we do it?
So, you know, just a little bit of a begging thing over here for all the brands who want to kind of, you know.
This has to be done in Hindi because there's a lot of money in central India.
Achha.
The cowbell, so to speak.
Okay.
Kripaya, dhyan dijiye. Lady or gentlemen, hum log ko paisa chahiye. Beek nahi mang rahe. Hum log sirf paisa chahiye. But... iske alawa, you will get...
you'll get advertising on podcasts, which are the most amazing podcasts.
Your child's birthday parties will be mentioned. Your anniversary, if you forget, we will tell everybody.
We will tell you.
How beautiful your wife is, we will tell you. So your marriage stays intact. How great your family is, how wonderful you are. What a great country you're in, or if you're in another country, how great that country is. All this and more.
All this and more.
Because we have no spine.
But just sponsor the podcast. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. We are completely open to bending over backwards for any sponsor.
Nothing in the backside. Nothing in the backside. All right, Abbas, what about you? Upcoming young comedian, what about you? What are you thinking about career-wise as well?
Take each day as it comes. Not thinking much about it.
These are Miss India answers. I hate them. I absolutely hate them. And you just did a show and, you know, you start talking to people. There's always guys who give you these very politically correct answers. What do you do? Business. This is not an answer.
I don't understand
what is business?
That, but I don't understand that.
Why can't
answer
they say
the
I don't
question?
Make plastics? Which is not right.
No, but I've gotten that answer to two questions a number of times.
Yeah.
I'm in business.
What is it?
The fuck does that mean?
Chota Rajan was in business.
What does it mean? I'm in business.
What is business?
Yeah.
Why can't you be specific? Yeah. Everybody has a business which is specific. Yeah. What the fuck is that?
I'm in business. What does that mean?
Listen, we don't want to be out of business, so we need your money, so quickly. Let's get back to the point, yeah. As for me, I expect nothing to change in India. I want to embrace all the things that I didn't like. I want to be touched more when I walk on the street. I want to find parking to be a big issue. I want to be stuck in Parel for one more hour. 1 hour is not enough. 2 hours, let me watch a full film.
You came on time today. Absolutely. You didn't get stuck today.
No, this is the other problem. Then suddenly there's no traffic and we look like liars. Because today we're actually 20 minutes early.
Yeah.
I dotted around downstairs for 5 minutes, feeling embarrassed to come up like I have no work. They'll be saying, "Uske paas kaam nahi hai, itna early aake wo." So you've got to be careful, yeah. But I think you just embrace the way India is and just accept that, you know, that we've functioned in spite of the chaos and nothing ever is going to change. Okay, around me, people are dying of the sniffles. My sound engineer just gave us an operatic rendition of Pavarotti with cold. And Amit, you've been sneezing throughout. So my last point, Abbas, and this is to you because you're wearing sweaters.
Yeah.
I was on a flight to Bangalore 2 days back and a gentleman, a very rich man, he sneezed and all the phlegm came on my right arm.
Awesome.
You know, he was very sweet. He apologized. He even offered to take it out. But I said more contact would be worse for me, right? Because that's where it actually happens. When you do sneeze, folks, the best thing to do is get into that umbilical sort of cord position where you put your head towards your groin.
And that fetal way, position.
Fetal position.
Umbilical cord.
But if you're looking for your umbilical cord, that's how you do it. My mom used to teach me big words when I was 6 months old and breastfeeding. She'd say, "Find your umbilical cord and then lickle it." And with that high standard of comedy, we end here. Thank you so much for joining us. We'll see you soon, or rather hear from you soon, or you can hear from us soon.
Yes.
Whatever works.
Yeah.
All right. You have something to say, Amit?
No.
Oh, thank God. Okay, catch us on any of the podcasting apps, please. We beg you, we need you. Send us your questions on Twitter, on Cyrus Says In. Or you can email us, even if you're not female, on whatcyrussays@gmail.com.
And that's what Cyrus says.
Hi, my name is Anupam Gupta. I'm B50 on Twitter. I am the host of Paisa Paisa, the show that talks money. On my show, I speak to experts from every field of money and finance, from stock markets, equities, debt funds, credit cards, life insurance, every possible area of money and finance that you can think of. We even did an episode on cryptocurrency. I've got fantastic guests from mutual funds to personal finance experts everywhere, robo-advisory startups, just name it, we've got it. At Paisa Paisa, we help you make smart decisions about money. You work hard for money. Now make your money work hard for you. New episodes out every Monday and you can listen to my show on the IVM Podcast app or any other podcasting app that you have.
Did you know that Parsis in Mumbai, instead of being left at the Tower of Silence after they die, are now cremated? And why? Because a cow fell sick in the early 1990s. Did you know that the smog in Delhi is caused by something that farmers in Punjab do and that there's no way to stop them? Did you know that there wasn't one gas tragedy in Bhopal, but three? One of them was seen, but two were unseen. Did you know that many well-intentioned government policies hurt the people they're supposed to help? Why was demonetization a bad idea? How should GST have been implemented? Why are all our politicians so corrupt when not all of them are bad people? I'm Amit Verma, and in my weekly podcast, The Seen and the Unseen, I take a shot at answering all these questions and many more. I aim to go beyond the scene and show you the unseen effects of public policy and private action. I speak to experts on economics, political philosophy, cognitive neuroscience, and constitutional law so that their insights can blow not only my mind, but also yours. The Seen and the Unseen releases every Monday. So do check out the archives and follow the show at seenunseen.in. You can also subscribe to The Seen and the Unseen on whatever podcast app you happen to prefer.